Well, hello there again, everybody. This is YouTube user uxwbill here, and I had some requests come in from some folks about making more computer videos, please, including, I believe it was YouTube user nsub6, who actually wrote in a comment, crawls out of the desert and dies. Well, hopefully YouTube user nsub6 will enjoy this video in spirit if they are no longer here with us. Going into my computer workroom here, which is a huge upside-down, topsy-turvy mess of every sort that you can imagine. I have computer junk over here. Some of this stuff needs to be parted out and scrapped. Some of it needs repairs, and some of it... Basically, I just need to stack it all up and clean it up again. And then over here, I have the working computer stack, including the Tandy 1000SX with the Diamond Trackstar Apple II emulation card. Just a cheap little no-name computer there in the middle. Dell, I think that's a Dimension 3000 sitting down there. And then behind it is the subject of this video. This is just a little bit of a treasure. See if you can figure out what's special about it while I work on getting it out of there. Now, in order to get started, we need to go back in time. Let's go back to about 1995 or so when my parents bought this RCA camcorder, which had two unique features. A 24 times optical zoom, as well as a digital zoom, and a digital signal processor that, according to RCA, was responsible for enabling various video fades and other clever modes of operation, and also an instant zoom feature. Also rather unique for this camera, and a feature that I have not seen often duplicated since, is an actual color viewfinder. Now, most cameras have got a little swing-out LCD screen that's color, but when it comes to the actual viewfinder that you put your eye up to, many of them still use the old black-and-white miniature television tube technology. But this camera actually used a liquid crystal display. I believe it's a passive matrix display from the looks of it. But it was a really cool feature at the time, and I don't recall seeing a whole lot of camcorders that claimed to have that feature. Now, this quickly became the camcorder that I shot videos with. I picked this thing up and took to it like a moth to a lamp, although hopefully with less disastrous results than the poor moth would have gotten to experience. This camera saw a lot of action. I recorded a lot of videotape on this thing, and it always held up well, despite the fact that it did not live an easy life. And one of the first and most unfortunate things to happen to it is right there. It slid off of a tripod mount that I didn't have it securely attached to, and it went crashing to the ground in about 1998 or so. Amazingly, that did not break it. So I put miles of videotape through this thing and used it basically from 1995 until 2005, although I had really toned down my video making activities by about 2001 or 2. It was actually YouTube user David Rock of David's Farm, who is sadly no longer really with us here on YouTube, unfortunately, due to the action of haters. And by the way, haters, this is not your invitation to turn this video comments section into a free-for-all, because I will moderate mercilessly if I have to, so don't go there. The man did what he did. His sins are his sins. He has to answer for them, and none of us can sit here and pontificate on them, so don't bother. But anyway, he got me back into making videos, and I discovered that not only did I have a copy of iMovie 06 at my disposal, but also a digital point-and-shoot camera that could make videos, and I got back into it. But this old camcorder was my standby for many years. It still works to this day, although it could definitely use a battery and a head cleaning. However, I had something else to go with it, and that is the computer below it. There's an interesting story behind the computer, as well as the camcorder. This computer was something that I came across when I was actually in a vocational education program during my high school years, when I would have been a junior and a senior in high school. Well, somehow or another, somebody found out that I was into computers and network administration and things like that. And although I certainly didn't know everything that I know now, I was soon conscripted into managing an NT domain, running at least one IBM RS6000 server, and doing various other things. And I soon became aware of just how unfortunate not having enough of a budget to get decent equipment is. Big companies would come by, and they would drop off pallets of machines that were all shrink-wrapped, as well as pallets of monitors, because it cost them nothing to do that, and they could probably write it off on their taxes, as opposed to simply throwing them in the dump or selling them to their employees. And the machines came in droves were these HP Vectra machines. First, there were desktops with Pentium 1 processors in them. Then there were towers with Pentium 2 processors, Pentium Pro processors in them. And then there were these towers which had Pentium 2 processors in them. There were never very many of these. But suffice it to say, the people who were working on these, there were about four of us guys working on them, and it was a cramped, hot room with no air conditioning. We had a couple workstations set up on folding tables, and our job was to crank these machines through and try to get them repurposed as fast as we could. Most of them became Windows NT workstations. Any machine that didn't work, we were under orders to dump it. And so I would throw these machines onto a pallet, and then they'd eventually get tossed into a dumpster. Well, I decided to put a stop to that one day, and so I just made off with a couple of them and hauled them home on the school bus, which probably made me a lot of friends with the school bus driver. But whatever the case may be, I came home with a couple of them, resold a few of them, which I thought was a pretty decent payout for what had been volunteer work, and I kept a couple behind for myself. Two HP Vectra VAs, one VL desktop, and this VL mini tower, which is a Pentium 2 and was originally clocked at 233 megahertz. I still have many of these machines, the ones that I decided to keep behind for myself and I didn't sell. In fact, the HP Vectra VA that you've seen mentioned in my FreeNAS video was actually the Keykeeper's computer, and was one of those computers that was slated to be thrown out. So, all these years later, they have survived. Now, my dad has carried the United States Mail for many years, and he's known a lot of people during that time, but one of the people that he has known was a mail carrier who was also into playing with computers, as I am, and this guy would go out and he'd buy stuff, and then a couple months later he'd get tired of playing with it, and he would sell it to the first person who had the cash. And that was how I came to have my second CD burner, this light-on 24x10x40 speed drive in the early 2000s. I slowly started to build this machine up at first into the computer that I used in my bedroom, and it was more than good enough for that task, although it had some reliability quirks, which I feel are probably a byproduct of the old Quantum 6 or so gigabyte hard drive that's in it, because that was what got most of these Vectras sidelined. Most of them had hard drives from Quantum that were so far past bad it wasn't even funny. This one just had minor personality traits from time to time that would cause the machine to behave strangely, but it would usually give you enough of a warning that getting your work saved and starting it over was not a big deal. And of course, I have backed up everything that I ever cared about off of this machine. So how does this tie into the video thing? Well, I'm glad you asked. Let me go around back and show you something. Okay, here I am on the back side of the machine looking at the expansion card slots. And as you can see over here, there's a card that's got an F connector on it. This is a Huppage Computer Works TV tuner. Now, maybe I'm not quite correct on the pronunciation there, but that's how I always pronounced it. Whatever the case, this card also has a composite video input, which is the yellow plug that you see on the bottom. And just above that is the audio line in. Well, I started playing with that thing after my dad bought it from that guy who he got the CD burner from for next to nothing. I think he gave maybe 20 bucks for it back in the day. And I discovered that it was quite possible for this machine to capture motion video. And while it couldn't do any kind of compression at all, because this card doesn't have any kind of hardware assistance, it was perfectly adequate for capturing uncompressed raw frames and then processing them with a video compressor later on. Somewhere further down the line, I took this thing a little bit further toward the goal. You can see the Quantum hard drive on the bottom, which is a 6 or so gigabyte unit, as this machine will not boot properly from any drive larger than 8.5 gigabytes, which is a curious limitation because usually the line is around 8. But up top, you can see a 40 gigabyte Western Digital drive that's much newer and was used to hold all my video. And that was no problem because this machine runs Windows 2000 and was therefore able to take over control from the system and display and utilize that 40 gigabyte drive to its maximum capability without regard for any system disk capacity limitations. This system was produced sometime in the middle or late end of 1997. Most of the date codes in it put it around the middle of 97 or so, and is one of the first systems to have actual USB ports as a part of its Intel 440 chipset. And although they are very early USB parts, and the chipset in this machine is marked in places with prototype notations, which is kind of odd for a production machine, but it's not the first time I've seen that, these USB ports are perfectly functional. So let me go ahead and hook this thing up, and go ahead and boot it up. Before I do that, though, here's a quick look at everything that's inside the system. First, we have the Intel Pentium 2 microprocessor. I remember when those things first came out in that oddball case, and that sure got people talking. This thing was originally equipped with a 233 megahertz processor. I later upgraded it to a 300 megahertz processor, but as you can see here, I had to do a little bit of modification to get it to fit because the heatsink was longer than Hewlett-Packard had really intended to go in this system. So I nibbled some of the plastic off here, and then I actually took a Dremel tool to my beloved microprocessor find, but it survived and works fine to this day. The cards in the system consist of a Sound Blaster 16 with an actual integrated SCSI host adapter. Yeah, no joke. It says SB16 SCSI right on it right there. SCSI, Small Computer System Interface. There are two Matrox video cards in here. One of them is an MGA Millennium. The other one is an MGA Mystique. Neither one of them has any video memory upgrades or the Rainbow Runner TV tuner accessory or anything like that. They're just run-of-the-mill PCI graphics cards, very good for their time, and some people would tell you unparalleled for their 2D capabilities today, although they're not much on three-dimensional stuff. Anyway, I had a dual monitor setup going with this thing. Have there, right there in between the sound card and one of the video cards, is a dual slot PC card adapter that I never really did anything with. And then way over on the end, look down here, you can see it better from above. There is the actual TV tuner card itself. Now, this system is actually old enough that it still uses SIMs, or single inline memory modules, for its working memory, or RAM, which is kind of unique for a Pentium II machine to still have SIMs in it. It was definitely a design holdover. I suspect that HP was probably just clearing out old parts from their Pentium Pro line and stuff. Now, I had to put memory back in this machine because I guess I borrowed some of it for something else, probably back when I was playing with the HP Vectra VA that I turned into the FreeNAS box and was trying to give as much memory to it as I possibly could. So I was, guess you could say I was robbing Peter to pay Paul in this case. Luckily, I have plenty of 32 megabyte EDO non-parity 72 pin SIMs sitting around, so I've got this machine restored to its previous configuration. Now, the only thing I'm not sure about, I'm not sure how well this machine will boot up. It's always had a little bit of personality that I have attributed to the fact it has a quantum hard drive in it that's probably not in the greatest shape ever, but it also probably has a dead clock battery, so throw the cover on and see what happens here. Here's the cover back on. Everything's ready to be turned on. Got my monitor over there waiting for me. Now, you might have noticed this clear power button and watched that with some interest. HP actually had a reason for making that button clear, and they solved two problems with this. First of all, they put the hard drive LED behind there. Second of all, the power LED is also behind there, and the two LEDs can actually be seen through that. There's a key lock down here that just locks the case onto the machine. It doesn't lock the keyboard out or anything like that. Believe it or not, most of these machines had their keys with them when they were donated to the school where I was doing this work, and this machine was no exception. So somewhere I actually do have the keys for this machine. I'm not sure if they're on my general purpose key ring or where they are, but they're definitely around. Let's go ahead and turn this thing on, and you can see the unique power button in action. That bright orange light is the hard drive LED, and when it vanishes, you'll be able to see the power LEDs, which takes just a couple of seconds here. Just enough for the power on self-test to complete. Alright, and there you have it. Now you can see the green power LEDs. There's the orange hard drive light again, and you'll notice how it's much brighter than the power LEDs are. Well, date and time lost, so I'm going to have to fix that, but then it should boot up, hopefully. Alright, there's the date set again. I think all the other options here in setup are pretty sane, so I won't play with them. Maybe I'll find out later that I needed to, but I don't recall having to change anything in here to match my preferences. No, it's not about 30 seconds. It's not about 40 seconds after midnight. That's just a convenient way to set it. I'll set the clock later when it boots up. Let's go ahead and reboot the machine here, see what it's willing to do. It takes a little bit for it to start itself over again. Hopefully I'll be able to demonstrate this machine for you. I don't know, it's been a long time since I had it powered up, and hopefully it hasn't gotten a little more characterful in the time that it's been sitting. But it used to be that every now and again you just get enough of a crash out of this thing or an application that would behave strangely, and you'd know that it was time to save your work and start it over again. Only very rarely did it ever fall into a stop error or anything like that. Like I say, it probably could have fixed it, but it really didn't matter to me at the time, and I don't think I'm going to put the effort into it now. Here we go. Let's see if it'll boot up. It was running Windows 2000. Oh, camera's telling me it needs its battery charged, so I guess I better go tend to that. Oh well, as it happens, as much as I wanted to give you a demonstration of this thing in action, and including the video capture card by hooking up the old school camcorder, since I don't yet have a video output cable suitable for use with this Handycam, as much as I wanted to do that, this machine just was not willing to play ball. I guess whatever went wrong finally went the rest of the way wrong, and that's that. Perhaps sometime I'll look into fixing it. Like I say, I really think it's the hard drive, but it's definitely thoroughly borked now.